event, maybe not as distinct from our other events, but particularly noticeable to me, is the amount of wisdom that is being displayed here. And it's being presented in such an unpretentious and accessible and humane way. Nobody's getting up on a platform and being the sage on the stage. And it's very different from a lot of other opportunities that I've had to hear some of this kind of content presented by other people. And I just wanted to point that out. I wanted to particularly thank the speakers that have been speaking since we came to lunch, because that came from lunch, because I think that was very distinguishing of their presentations. And I wanted to say that especially because I'm supposed to introduce Jane Strait, who's going to speak next. And I really consider Jane to be a truly extraordinary person. I think the most correct thing from my perspective that I could say about her is that she's a witch. And she's a person of incredible power. Plants love her. She knows how to encourage them to help us in ways that most of us don't have access to. She's a tremendous resource in the community, and she's so unpretentious and unself-aggrandizing about it that it's really remarkable, and it's a pleasure and a privilege to know her and present her.
Thank you, and I really appreciate being here. And I absolutely love the Women's Visionary Congress events. I feel so supported, loved, nourished, and I'm ecstatic. Thank you. And I do get nervous before I speak, so bear with me. I'll mellow out in a little bit. I chose to speak about harm reduction. And, let me back up a minute. When I got here this morning, the streets were empty, and I flash back on years of vending in Oakland, right here. And I haven't done it for quite a while, but, or seriously, quite a while. But I'd come here a couple times a week with a vehicle full of herb that growers from Northern California would bring to me, and I was really the only woman, and certainly the only elder woman, that sat in the waiting rooms of all these different places that would purchase herb, and it was usually a lot of young guys, and but what I found was that they really appreciated me. And I was kind of like grandma to them, or their mother, you know, mothers. And so I had a lot of flashbacks. Right down the street was the first dispensary here, and that was Richard Lee's Bulldog Coffee House. We'd walk up these crickety steps, and you'd go meet with Tim, his buyer. Tim's a great guy, he's got his own scene. And yeah, so I was down memory lane. You want to put this? Oh, yep. Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay, so there was the Bulldog Coffee House, and that was quite an adventure. And then right next to the Bulldog was, I believe it was the first grow shop in the area, and that was the Four Seasons. And I'd go from one place to another, and I'd bring plants down for Andrew at the at Four Seasons, and he'd line them up along the sidewalk and the curbside, and people would come and buy these beautiful brugmansias and salvias and cacti that I would bring. So this holds a special place in my heart. So it's fun to be here today. So now, I chose harm reduction. I wanted to talk about it, harm reduction for us as patients and users of cannabis, but also how cannabis has served as harm reduction for opioid dependence and addiction. So I'm going to start with the opioid crisis in the U.S., and I'm going to give you some boring but pretty telling statistics. The U.S. claims 5% of the world population, and we use 80% of the opioids. Hello. What's wrong with that picture? And what that means, though, is that many other parts of the world don't have access to the opioids that we are consuming, 80% of them. 44 people die every day from opioid overdose. And I read this, and I keep looking at it. 7,000 people are treated in the ER every day from misuse of opioid prescription drugs. Pretty scary. Nearly 60% of US patients take their opioids in combo with other drugs known to make them more dangerous. And the current opioid use in the NFL is 3 times that of the general population. So we have the doctor's dilemma, right? They don't think they have another option, and they just keep prescribing more and more and more as people build tolerance to the medications that they're taking. We know that adding cannabis to opioids makes them safer. Yeah. It's just a matter of how do we really do that? And it's all trial and error. Well, no, a lot of it is trial and error, and people are starting to figure this out. We also know that cannabis can prevent opioid tolerance building and the need for dose escalation. And one of the biggest problems with long-term use is tolerance. Cannabis can also effectively treat the symptoms of opioid withdrawal and is safer than any other harm reduction option available. It's also interesting to note that there's no evidence, none, zip, supporting the use of long-term opioids as an effective treatment modality. But there is an increased risk of serious harm. We also know that cannabis can effectively treat chronic pain. When I was writing this up, I was thinking, okay, cannabis and opioids. What about cannabis and poppy head tea? I mean, how many of you have utilized poppy head tea for pain? Cool. A few of us. Great. Let me just tell you, can I give you a little recipe so that you know? Okay. Thank you. I just had to ask. If you want a really effective pain medicine, take 7 dry poppy heads and crush them. A little coffee grinder works really well. Put those 7 dry crushed pods in 2 cups of water. Bring it to a boil and then turn it down right away. Add lemon, fresh lemon juice to help extract alkaloids, and let that simmer maybe 20 minutes or so, turn it off, cool it, and I use maple syrup to make it really palatable, and you can keep that in the fridge for at least a week, maybe 2 weeks. And I usually suggest somebody start with half a cup to see where that takes them. And you can use it in preference to any kind of prescription meds, opioids. So I'm hoping that some of you will try it. And it's hard, let's see. Pardon me? Well, the papaver somniferum, the true opium poppy.
The red ones.
Well, they're all kind of purple ones work, the double white, big, the maxi pods. They all have the medicine.
Not California.
No. Well, California poppy, California poppy is really good as a sedative, but it isn't the same deal. It doesn't take your pain away necessarily. And I will never forget, and I always tell this story, I think, of a Japanese Shinto priest that came to see me. I remember when I was working here in Oakland, here's another job I had, working with Richard Lee, and at the end of the night, they would give me my money, which was a lot, and give me a little bag of herb, and I would take that herb and sell it to somebody else or give it to somebody, and I would stop and pick up some cannabis edibles, and I would take them to my friend, and that was what would relieve his cancer symptoms. He was dying, he was getting really sick and very, very uncomfortable. And at the end of his life, he asked for the poppy head tea, because that way he could be consciously with his loved ones. And it would take the edge, seriously, take the edge off his chronic pain, debilitating pain. He was at the end of his life. So, I think in the state of California, you can have poppy seeds, but you can't plant them. It's like, hello, who makes these rules and regulations? My goodness, you can have the seeds, but you can't plant them. I think it's pretty safe to say that you can plant them if you don't score them, right? So it looks like when you score them, you're going for the sap, I would just say plant as many as you possibly can. This is something that it's something that we really want to have in our medicine bags, and we want to have a lot of them because there are a lot of people in chronic pain. You can also get them at flower markets, but I'm guessing they're not grown organically. But I would possibly rather have, go ahead.
Well, because poppies would be opium and, then heroin, it doesn't make you addicted in the same way heroin does to the opioid.
I've never had that experience. I can't say that positively. I'm not really, really sure. And somebody else may know that better than I do, but I believe that it's a far cry safer to use the poppy heads than anything else. And if it's a choice between a pharmaceutical opioid and becoming addicted to poppy head tea, I'd sign me up for the tea. They are hard to come by, so get some seeds and grow them. Grow a lot of them. I remember in Sebastopol, where I lived for a long time, there were opium poppies growing at the police station, and also cannabis. People would, it's pretty cute. We're West County was pretty out there, and it was always really fun to see that. And grannies always grow poppies. They're gorgeous. They're absolutely gorgeous. I lived with a fellow that was very addicted to many things. And he, one season, our garden was totally purple. He had planted it out in poppies. And when the purple petals fell, the garden was just exquisite. It was like this, you know, like it had snowed purple poppy petals. It was just gorgeous. So please, grow poppies. In a nutshell, cannabis and opioids work synergistically to reduce pain. Then you add CBD to the mix. It reduces THC side effects while enhancing the benefits. And it can decrease addictive behavior. And I'm seeing this firsthand. I have a couple of friends that have very, very serious alcohol problems. And I hesitated to give them, you know, another drug. But CBD medicine has been so beneficial, and I'm watching these people do a turnaround with their addictive behavior. It's pretty impressive. Let me turn my page. The Journal of the American Medical Association says, quote, passing a state medical cannabis law, on average, reduced opioid overdose by 24.8%. That's huge. That's huge. So, grow poppies, grow cannabis, and use them. I just wanted to plant the seed. Really, no pun intended. That's just, that is a natural. I wanted you to know about Amanda Ryman from DPA. I thought actually she was going to be here today. Amanda has done a lot of work on the opioid crisis and using cannabis. So you can find her online, Amanda Ryman, R-I-E-M-A-N. She works with Drug Policy Alliance. I think her thing is cannabis policy. You can also check, I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Dr. Dustin Sulak, S-U-L-A-K. He's on the East Coast, but he's been talking online and at conferences for a long time. He's a young doctor, very handsome. He says between their clinics, they have treated thousands of people with cannabis, thousands effectively. And he has a website called healer.com. And you can sign up for his newsletter. And you can go through his courses. He doesn't charge anything. I mean, you can pay him $1 million if you have it, and I'm sure he'll take it. But you can sign up for nothing and have access to all of the information he has online, and it's vast. And he speaks to the opioid issue and very eloquently. Then there is also Green Flower online. Check Green Flower. You can sign up for their online newsletter. And every day they will give you a little blip. And they offer a lot of, I guess they're webinars for free. And they'll give you advance notice. You know, you sign up, and maybe tomorrow night they'll have one on cannabis and pregnancy. And in fact, is Stacy still here? I told her before when I walked out that, hi Stacy, that I had seen her originally on the Green Flower Network. And there's also, of course, Project CBD, and with our own Northern California, Martin Lee, bless his heart. And they speak to the opioid issue. So I'm just planting the seed. And Tara had asked me if I would address what good medicine is in terms of how do you go about finding good medicine? How do you know good medicine? But I think we touched on that quite a bit before lunch, so I don't think I really need to go there. Of course, grow your own if you can, possibly. If you can't, find somebody that you know that's growing organically. And if you really can't, if you don't know anybody, I guess you have to try to find a dispensary that you can start to trust. And we were having, I've had a little conversations with a number of people this morning or today, and it's hard going to a dispensary, and as an elder, we were talking, how would an elder know how to, how would somebody that hasn't been in the movement for a long time, anybody, how would somebody know how to navigate a dispensary? I know somebody that she was writing a piece on that she was, that was her work, and I don't know if she's done it or not. She's in Sonoma County, but she was going to do a handbook for people to guide them through a dispensary. You definitely want your medicine to have a very, very pungent or fragrant aroma when you open a jar or a bag. That way you know that it's one, fresh, and that all the terpenes, the essential oils of the cannabis plant haven't been destroyed. If you open a bag or a jar and it doesn't hardly smell like anything, yuck, you wouldn't want to deal with it. So I'm just hoping that that everybody in the future, that we will all have access to clean medicine. And they're all the...
There's a good self-test if you have the opportunity to smoke the herb. When you ash the joint, you rub it on your hand like this. If it's not organic and it's grown with something petrochemical, it's going to leave a black, greasy stain on it. But herb that's actually been properly cured is going to leave a clean, white ash. So if you have the opportunity to smoke, you can always just notice that in your little self-test. Like, what's the ash smell like? Because when it's burned and it's combusted all the way properly and it's cured properly, there's not going to be anything, any smell or any greasy residue left. That's not necessarily practical at the dispensary unless they're letting you smoke
right.
Outside.
Right,
but you would know the next time, hey, you said you gave me something organic that was chemical-free, and actually this happened for me.
Thank you, Trish. And this is what I was hoping that everybody would have. I mean, there's so much information in this room. Thank you. Okay, so what are some of the other issues or ways that we can protect ourselves as patient users? Well, moderation is key. And when I mentioned Dustin Sulak, a big part of his work is helping people titrate in a way that we actually are using less and less, which is a beautiful thing. Edibles is a way to eliminate smoking. Some people like edibles, some people don't. Set and setting. I didn't think about that so much until very recently when I had an experience for a couple of weeks where I was more challenged emotionally. And when I did my regular high THC Jack Frost one day, it blew me away. I was shaking. It was not the right medicine for me at all. And I had to go to my my CBD rich tincture to kind of settle me down and some rescue remedy. Hydration is huge. I think that the only thing that we have really come up with that might be a negative part of cannabis smoking is dry mouth. We've all experienced cotton mouth where our lips stick together and we can hardly talk and it's like, whoa. It's kind of funny, but it's actually can be a serious oral health issue. And what happens, THC actually deactivates two of our three saliva glands. So that's why we get cotton mouth. And there are a number of things we can do. In Ayurveda, they say sucking on a licorice root can help hydrate. They also talk about oil pulling as hydration for the mouth if we're smokers. And I've smoked, I was thinking about this, I have smoked, I smoked for the first time when I was 16. That's over 50 years ago. It's a long time. And I have oral health issues. And I thought, whoa, well, part of that's genetic, but also I bet part of that's because I've smoked cannabis for over 50 years. So first thing in the morning, prayers, and then my oil pulling, which I think is really making a difference. They talk about using citrus and lemon in particular. I've got lemon water right here with me. Those are really easy ways to eliminate the dry mouth situation. Then also in Ayurveda, they talk about calamus root, Acarus calamus. And Acarus calamus can help... Acarus calamus, a bunch of different things, but it helps lubricate the dry mucous membranes. And I actually brought a bunch of little packets of organic Acarus calamus, and they're on the end of that altar in a little wooden dish. And I would suggest everybody take one of these and try it, because not only does Acarus calamus prevent that dry mucous membrane situation, but it also has the ability to neutralize other, you know, like the foggy thinking that we sometimes experience with cannabis. Acarus calamus is a cerebral circulator. It just adds another dimension to cannabis experience, and there's nothing wrong with doing it. It won't hurt you, and you just take a little teeny pinch of it and put and mix it in with your smoke. It's considered a smoke plant. And nobody knows about it, really. I read about it maybe 20 years ago in one of my first Ayurvedic herb books. And I used it in it.
Can you repeat the name, please?
Yes. Acarus is A-C-O-R-U-S. Calamus, C-A-L-A. M-U-S. Mm-hmm.
Can you vaporize it?
Pardon me?
Can you vaporize it?
Can you vaporize it? That's a good question. Probably. Oh, we've only got 5 minutes. Okay, better go fast. Thank you. Okay, how about cannabis and alcohol? Poly drug use. That's one of the things that kind of frightened me about cannabis recreationally, as I could see many people going, you know, being really high on cannabis and then going to the bar, or the other way around, you drink. Okay, so if you are using cannabis with alcohol, you want to have your cannabis in your system first. Otherwise, if you drink alcohol first, it can ramp up the absorption process and make your experience much more intense. So smoke first or use first before you drink alcohol. Oh no, no, we don't have much more time. Okay. Then we have all the vape pens, and that's like a whole big can of worms. Apparently, in current California regulations, they're very loose. Nobody's really paying much attention to all these vape pens, and they have some very potentially damaging cutting agents, hydrocarbons, that are neurotoxic. And so you want to look at what's in the oils that you put into the vape pens, and you want to be very, you don't want to get anything that has propylene glycol, and then PEG, which is the acronym for polyethylene glycol, which has something to do with formaldehyde. You don't want vegetable glycerin, butane, propane, hexane. And I want to say one more thing about butane. It's gotten a really, really bad rap, and that's because of how it's being utilized. It's usually considered toxic. However, butane extraction is actually a safe and perfectly clean method when used in a professional closed-loop solvent extraction system. And that comes from Valerie Correll, who knows her stuff. So much more, I'm sorry. Okay, everybody knows Neil Young, of course. One of his favorite antidotes for paranoia when he gets high is peppercorns, and you've probably heard this before. You can either chew a few peppercorns, you can crunch them up and sniff them, or you can use black pepper essential oil. So that would be a really good one to keep in your bag of tricks. Lavender, of course, lemon balm, things that calm us. Like I said before, Rescue Remedy is great. Bring you right back into your body. I want to say something about the liver. THC over long-term use can be really hard on your liver. So you want to, I'm just throwing out things to think about. Because a lot of us are long-term users. And how do we work with our liver? How do we clean our liver? Milk thistle, dandelion, parsley. And then we want to add antioxidants. Be aware of using antioxidants, because smoking of any kind is going to introduces free radicals and unstable molecules. So even though cannabis has never been linked to lung cancer, it's just a good thing to be conscious of. Okay, can I say one more thing? Okay. You know, there are a lot of discrepancies in the cannabis world, and one of the biggest ones is how you decarb, the decarboxylation. And I'm just going to give you a couple, I'm going to read down just a couple things here. Decarbing is heating it, of course, and we heat it when we smoke it to change THCA into THC. Okay, here are some of the different temperatures that I've recorded that are in different books or online. Valerie Correll says 250 to 312. As the oven temperature that you want to decarb in. A spa book says 300 degrees Fahrenheit for 30 minutes or more. Somebody else says 220 for 90 minutes. Somebody says over 300 for 7 minutes. So I'm looking for the definitive. I want to know what the true decarb temperature is, and if anybody knows, please tell me. You do?
240 degrees.
How do you know?
What did you say?
Chemists, I know, take it to a different level, so they figure that out.
How long?
For how long?
For 30 minutes.
30 minutes.
Depending on the material.
Yes. Thank you.
Can you repeat that for us?
240 degrees Fahrenheit for 30 minutes, depending upon the material.
Stacy.
If you're going to do it in your oven, cover it with foil or something, because otherwise your oven gets covered with resin and it's a real mess.
Yep. Okay, but what do you think about covering it with foil? I think if, like glass, like a glass covered glass Pyrex dish to keep the terpenes from evaporating, but not messing it up with the foil. Okay. Oh, I have a lot more. I'm sorry.
Can you just say something about the altar before you get finished?
Pardon me?
Would you just say some little thing about the altar before you get finished?
Yes. This is one of my traveling altars. And there is some cannabis there. There is one species of coca. There's a little peyote button. There's lemon balm if you want to smell it. I can show you what it is. There's lavender. There's some black peppercorns on there. These things come from my garden, and they choose to come to every event. I mean, they call me each time. It's never the same. And that's my love. Thank you. See you.
Thank you so much, Dane.